Hybridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Junk Food Politics, How Beverage and Fast Food Industries Are Reshaping Emerging Economies, by Eduardo J. Gómez. Read by Timothy Andrés Pabon. Preface. I love London coffee shops. They welcome diverse groups of people, are always lively, and often are the best place to mingle, read, and generate big ideas. My idea for this book emerged in such a place. Sipping a dark cafezinho one afternoon in West London, I chanced upon an online news article discussing the power of food-based interest groups for influencing university research in ways that made U.S. healthcare officials overlook the harmful health effects of sugar. I could not believe how influential these interest groups were. At the same time, I began to realize that many of the most innovative programs for preventing obesity and type 2 diabetes around the world were not working as well as expected. After several years of policy innovations in countries such as Brazil and Mexico, cases of obesity and type 2 diabetes were burgeoning, and even more worrisome, it was happening at an alarming rate among vulnerable populations, such as children and the poor. Why? Could it be that a major external force, such as the political and social prowess of major food industries, was hampering the design and implementation of these policies? A flame was lit. A big idea emerged. And I endeavored to find answers to this vexing question. I soon realized that providing an answer to this question required an in-depth, comparative historical analysis of how major food and beverage industries came to wield great influence, how these industries were shaping politics, policy, and society, and how or even if governments should work with these industries in response. I wondered, in emerging middle-income countries seeing a rapid increase in foreign direct investment and economic growth, whether recent transitions to democracy and electoral institutions could safeguard vulnerable populations from the industry's policy influence and their unhealthy products. Were politicians genuinely committed to protecting children and the poor from consuming these products too much and preventing their associated ailments? Were presidential, congressional, and bureaucratic institutions adapting by learning how to grapple with this new public health challenge? In my mind, writing a book was the only fitting way to address these concerns adequately. Books require a lot of work, commitment, and support. Writing one is a marathon. I had the honor and privilege along the way of working with amazing colleagues. I would like first to thank my editor at Johns Hopkins University Press, Robin Coleman, as well as the editorial board at Hopkins, for providing me with the opportunity to have this book published. Robin offered in-depth comments, support, and encouragement along the way. Robert Brown, a production editor at Hopkins, did a brilliant job of working with me on polishing the end product. I would also like to thank other colleagues and research assistants for their thoughts and suggestions at different stages of research and writing. Ali Wollick, Nino Dotsenzidi, James McGuire, Joseph Harris, and Tara Kesserum. Finally, my family and friends were there for me throughout the process. My father, Guillermo L. Gomez, never failed to offer a listening ear and encouragement. When I wasn't writing, my dear friends Patrick Crotty, Ash Hook, Fatima Wakil, and Robert Hargrove, along with my family away from home at the Roger Gracie Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu Academy in West London, were always available for respite and support. It was a long haul, but my peeps helped push me across the finish line. Introduction. In 2016, Dr. Margaret Chan, who was China's first woman to serve as Director General of the World Health Organization, WHO, delivered a keynote address to the National Academy of Medicine. She was a leader. She was a visionary. And she had an important message. Speaking to a captivated audience, Director Chan discussed the need to tackle the burgeoning epidemic of obesity and type 2 diabetes. Toward the end of her presentation, she argued that one of the primary reasons for the emergence of these epidemics was the lack of political will to tackle the interests and power of big industry. Specifically, she commented, "When crafting preventive strategies, government officials must recognize that the widespread occurrence of obesity and diabetes throughout a population is not a failure of individual willpower to resist fats and sweets or exercise more. It is a failure of political will to take on the powerful food and soda industries. If governments understand this duty, the fight against obesity and diabetes can be won. The interests of the public must be prioritized over those of corporations. In essence, this book seeks to address why many of our most thriving emerging economies today have neglected to fulfill Dr. Chan's call to duty of taking on the interests and power of major junk food industries, defined here as multinational and domestic soda and ultra-processed food companies. Achieving this requires policies that not only effectively inform consumers, such as by ensuring the provision of accurate and reliable food labels, but also to effectively regulate the marketing and sale of their products, especially toward vulnerable populations, such as children and the poor. Unfortunately, for most countries in the developing world, governments have neglected to earnestly pursue these marketing and sales regulatory policies, instead allowing junk food industries to thrive and prosper, but at the expense of the deteriorating health of these vulnerable populations. An intriguing puzzle emerges. Despite the absence of these much-needed regulatory policies, several of the world's biggest emerging economies, such as Mexico, Brazil, India, China, Indonesia, and South Africa, have done a commendable job of implementing a host of innovative obesity and type 2 diabetes prevention programs. Indeed, in these emerging economies, which are the focus of this book, governments have unleashed a myriad of innovative public awareness campaigns and funding for nutritional and exercise programs, and in some instances, have even introduced controversial soda taxes. Mexico was a global leader in this last regard, being the first in the world to adopt national soda taxes in 2013. What's more, in 2010, Brazil was recognized by the international community, along with the United Kingdom, for its policy innovations in tackling obesity. Nevertheless, these governments have repeatedly neglected to take on the power of big industry by failing to enact effective regulatory policies circumscribing industry's ability to communicate, market, and sell their products, especially to vulnerable populations. These policy outcomes have emerged at a time when the majority of childhood obesity cases are soaring in these high-growth, emerging markets throughout the Americas, Asia, and Africa, and where type 2 diabetes is now prevalent among adults and adolescents. In fact, according to the WHO, the vast majority of overweight or obese children live in developing countries, where the rate of increase has been more than 30% higher than that of developed countries. Addressing this puzzling situation requires an in-depth comparative historical analysis of the complex world of junk food politics. In this book, I argue that there is a context of fear and opportunity, that is, junk food industries continuously fear the prospect of losing revenue in the industrialized West, and opportunities abound for investment in the emerging economies. With a rising middle income class and increased consumer spending, more than ever, industries have had incentives to engage in several political, institutional, and civil societal tactics, facilitating their ability to stymie the creation and implementation of regulatory policies. From engaging in innovative policy partnerships with government, to reshaping bureaucratic institutions and civil societal actors in their favor, these industries have garnered the political legitimacy and influence needed to achieve this policy objective. But industries are only partly to blame. Governments are equally responsible. Basically, junk food politics is a two-way street. While industries have worked hard to influence government, political leaders have had a historic track record of partnering with industry to achieve their alternative policy and thus political agendas. Powerful presidents in Mexico, Brazil, India, China, Indonesia, and South Africa have viewed these industries as necessary allies, helping these heads of state implement a host of economic and social welfare programs, and in the process, contributing to their nation's developmental prospects. But more importantly for these leaders, they have benefited politically, as partnering with industry has helped them to fulfill their economic and social welfare objectives, and thus achieve electoral promises. In this context, industry's political tactics have been indirectly supported by presidential partnership and political ambition. To better understand and explain the complex world of junk food politics, this book introduces an analytical framework titled The Industry Politics and Complementary Institutions, IPCI. To my knowledge, this framework is the first to unify several theoretical schools of thought in political science and public health policy to guide our analysis, and more importantly, provide a more thorough explanation of the junk food industry's political and policy influence in several emerging economies. As I explain in Chapter 1, this framework begins by focusing on the broader historical context of fear and opportunity, where more than ever, industry fears of dwindling global profits, when combined with new investment opportunities in the emerging economies, have generated incentives for junk food industries to influence politics, society, and policy. In this historical context, the IPCI emphasizes that industries have engaged in several political processes, ranging from the formation of health policy partnerships with government officials to industry lobbying, the provision of largesse, and the strategic infiltration of bureaucratic institutions. At the same time, the IPCI underscores industry's efforts to restructure society in its favor, that is, by establishing civil societal partnerships and providing social services while strategically using these partnerships to generate divisions in society and ultimately to undermine collective opposition against industry. And finally, this framework introduces the important concept of complementary institutions. In other words, the historical and contemporary incentives that presidents have to partner with and use industry for political objectives. These partnerships ultimately serve to indirectly supplement the political tactics and influence of junk food industries, while emphasizing the fact that governments and their political leaders are also to blame for industry's ongoing political influence over noncommunicable diseases, NCDs. When taken together, the IPCI provides greater insight into why junk food industries continue to have the political legitimacy and influence needed to repeatedly undermine the introduction and effectiveness of NCD regulatory policies. Nevertheless, this approach also helps to explain why several of our biggest emerging economies have neglected to achieve Director Chan's call to duty on taking on the power and interests of big business. Sometimes it seems that political leaders benefit more from seeing these industries thrive and prosper, sadly, to the detriment of the health of our children and the poor. Understanding junk food politics.
Applying my analytical framework to the cases of Mexico, Brazil, India, Indonesia, China, and South Africa helps to provide a thorough explanation of the junk food industry's political interference in NCD regulatory policy.
In Mexico, the presence and influence of these industries emerged shortly after the introduction of free market reforms, for instance, free trade and deregulation. This context allowed industries such as Coca-Cola to obtain an early foothold in the market, becoming important economic and political entities. As the public health challenges of obesity and type 2 diabetes emerged, however, the government was slow to respond. After several years of scientific warnings from Mexico's National Institute of Public Health, the government implemented national prevention programs focusing on NCD awareness and improved nutrition, while regulatory policies targeting the marketing and sale of junk food products were eventually introduced, they were poorly enforced and mostly ignored. For the most part,
These outcomes were the product of the junk food industry's apparent legitimacy and policy influence, facilitated through several political and social tactics. These tactics included working closely with Department of Health officials to create health and educational programs in schools, lobbying, and engaging in largesse, mainly via electoral campaign contributions, while infiltrating national bureaucratic advisory committees in order to safeguard industries' ideas and policy interests. These industries also engaged in several partnerships with academic researchers and non-governmental organizations, NGOs, but to the detriment of civil society's ability to mobilize and hold industries accountable for their actions. Despite these challenges, activists continue to draw attention to the need to address Mexico's childhood obesity and diabetes problem. Though initially struggling to gain government recognition and influence, in recent years, activists and NGOs have highlighted the junk food industry's harmful effects and drawn greater attention to the need for more aggressive regulatory action. Nevertheless, industry's political tactics and influence were also indirectly supported by Mexico's powerful presidents, such as Vicente Fox, PAN, 2000 to 2006, Felipe Calderón, PAN, 2006 to 2012, and Enrique Peña Nieto, PRI, 2012 to 2018. These leaders partnered with soda and ultra-processed food companies in order to achieve their alternative economic and social welfare agendas, such as implementing popular anti-hunger campaigns. This kind of strong presidential support, what the IPCI refers to as an example of complementary institutions, further emboldened industry's political legitimacy and, unfortunately, its ongoing policy influence. Mexico's neighbor to the south, Brazil, faced similar challenges. There, major junk food industries emerged following the transition to democracy and free market reforms, a process facilitating and encouraging investment in the soda, snack food, and fast food sectors. Despite an increase in obesity and type 2 diabetes cases among Brazil's most vulnerable populations, the government was slow to respond. And when it did eventually respond, the Ministry of Health's MOH focus was first on providing innovative prevention programs with an emphasis on information and awareness. While regulations restricting the marketing and sale of products were eventually introduced, they were either limited, ignored, or blocked by industry interests. And to this day, the government has not implemented or even attempted to introduce a tax on sodas and junk foods. Similar to what we saw in Mexico, these outcomes were the product of several industries' efforts to engage in health policy partnerships with the MOH, lobbying and largesse via campaign donations, while strategically infiltrating national regulatory agencies such as Anvisa, Brazil's national regulatory agency for food, pharmaceutical, tobacco, and other healthcare services. Nevertheless, major industries such as PepsiCo, Coca-Cola, and Nestle also provided several corporate social responsibility activities, ranging from the provision of community employment programs to supporting gay rights campaigns. Helpful in building social allies, these industry efforts nevertheless contributed to divisions in society between those that supported industry and those that did not, in turn hampering nutrition activists' ability to mobilize in opposition. Despite these challenges, the activist community continues to strive to address industry's harmful effects in society, and especially among children and the poor. And yet, the onus of responsibility cannot solely be placed on junk food industries. The government has also been responsible for industry's ongoing policy influence. Indeed, Brazil's presidents, such as Luiz Inácio Lula da Silva, PT, 2002 to 2010, appear to have benefited from establishing a strong partnership with industry leaders, strategically using them to achieve popular anti-poverty measures. Lula even went so far as to create federal institutions that would sustain this partnership with industry. Strong presidential backing or what I refer to as complementary institutions, indirectly contributed to these industries' political legitimacy and policy influence. India, Brazil's counterpart in South Asia, is also experiencing similar challenges. Although junk food industries initially struggled to enter India's market due to the presence of a nationalist socialist government, free market reforms beginning in the 1990s generated new incentives and opportunities for several industries, mainly foreign, to capture and develop the market. India's government faced the dual burden of malnutrition, however, where ongoing undernutrition was soon accompanied by a high level of obesity and type 2 diabetes cases, surging in recent years among children and the poor. In this complex nutritional context, the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, MHFW, was considerably delayed in providing several NCD prevention programs. While Parliament eventually succeeded in adopting a sin tax on sodas and junk foods in 2017, ineffective regulations emerged in the area of food labeling. The marketing of these products has instead relied on ineffective industry self-regulation, sans government involvement. While to this day, not a single piece of legislation exists regulating junk food sales, especially toward children. Industry politics has once again interfered, contributing to these policy outcomes. These outcomes were influenced by industry's efforts to partner with government on several innovative NCD prevention programs, aggressive lobbying, as well as industry's infiltration of federal regulatory agencies. At the same time, several companies, such as PepsiCo, Coca-Cola, and Nestle, have invested in local communities by providing health and other social welfare services. While broadening their support base, these efforts have nevertheless divided society and its ability to mobilize against industry's political activities and policy influence. While new and emerging, nutritionist activists in India are nevertheless making excellent progress in drawing attention to these industry tactics, raising greater awareness about the need to improve children and the poor's nutrition and overall health, while pressuring the government to adopt more aggressive regulatory policies. However, once again, industry politics is only partly to blame. In India, the government has also done its part in contributing to industry's ongoing policy influence. Indeed, as seen in Mexico and Brazil, India's political leaders such as Prime Minister Narendra Modi, 2014 to present, of the Bharatiya Janata Party, have relied on junk food industries as vital partners in achieving Modi's objective of increasing foreign direct investment, economic growth, and prosperity for all. By working with industry to achieve these alternative economic objectives, though, Modi has indirectly bolstered the political legitimacy and influence of these industries, while helping him maintain popular support. Here, once again, complementary institutions have only served to benefit industry, ultimately at the expense of improving the health of children and the poor. Indonesia, India's neighbor to the south, also saw the gradual emergence of a thriving junk food industry, kindled by the expeditious transition to free market reforms and decentralization. Similar to India, the double burden of malnutrition contributed to delays in the MOH's policy response. While MOH prevention programs eventually emerged, efforts to introduce a soda tax were nevertheless short-lived. Few, if any, regulatory efforts were made in the areas of food labeling, marketing, and sales. And this has occurred amid the burgeoning growth of obesity and type 2 diabetes cases among the island's most vulnerable populations. But why did this occur? Industries and their supportive interest groups were successful mainly due to their aggressive lobbying efforts, while incessantly pressuring legislators to refrain from adopting a soda tax. Although close policy partnerships were never pursued with government, several junk food industries engaged in a wide range of corporate social responsibility initiatives in order to establish social legitimacy and influence. Nevertheless, these activities contributed to growing divisions in society, where industry partnerships with nutrition scientists and NGOs reduced the number of allies that activists could work with to mobilize and confront industry's ongoing policy influence. In this challenging context, and despite the fact that civil society's presence in the area of nutrition has only recently emerged, activists are doing a commendable job of raising awareness about obesity and type 2 diabetes and the double burden of malnutrition while calling for more aggressive industry regulations. At the same time, however, Indonesia's presidents have also indirectly contributed to the junk food industry's success. Recent presidents, such as Susilo Bambang Yudhoyono, commonly referred to by his initials SBY, 2004 to 2014, and Jokowi Widodo, 2014 to present, have established close partnerships with several major industries in order to help accelerate economic development, provide food security, and reduce poverty. But unfortunately, these complementary institutions once again appear to have indirectly contributed to industry's ongoing political and NCD policy influence. By far Asia's largest economy, China has also seen the consequences of complex junk food politics. After several years of political isolation from the West and a closed-off economy, major multinational industries emerged to capture the market, instigate development, and establish a strong foothold in the economy. Amid an escalating increase in childhood obesity and type 2 diabetes cases, the MOH was slow to respond, and when it did, it emphasized a host of NCD prevention and awareness campaigns. In addition to highlighting sound nutrition, most of these prevention programs were focused on the importance of daily physical exercise, especially for children. Despite these impressive campaigns, a soda tax was never introduced. Worse still, no effort has been made to create effective food labels. While no legislation exists regulating the marketing and sale of these foods to children, this in turn has incentivized industries to aggressively market their products to children and the poor. But why has this occurred? Once again, industries have been highly adept at influencing prevention and regulatory policy in their favor. As we saw in other countries, one key strategy has been these industries' policy partnerships with government, such as helping improve nutrition and exercise in schools. At the same time, industries have engaged in several lobbying tactics, though mainly through informal meetings with policymakers. Perhaps industry's most effective strategy has been its strategic infiltration of the China Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, CDC, and industry's ability to inculcate its policy ideas by establishing strong linkages with policymakers within the China CDC. This tactic has allowed major companies like Coca-Cola to work through supportive NGOs, such as the International Life Sciences Institute, to establish the importance of physical exercise for preventing childhood obesity within the China CDC. What's more, industries have engaged in a wide variety of corporate social responsibility CSR activities, in turn aiding industries in their ability to increase their community support and social legitimacy. The dearth of NGOs that are working on advocating for improved nutrition among China's most vulnerable communities means that these CSR activities have not contributed to divisions within society. And unfortunately, while civic awareness and interests in improving China's obesity and type 2 diabetes situation has increased for a variety of political reasons, ranging from government suspicion of activist activities, especially those linked to foreign NGOs, and a reluctance to incorporate civil society's views, NGOs still have not had the space and opportunity needed to successfully hold industries accountable while pressuring government for NCD regulatory policies. Once again, further complicating matters is the central government's efforts to partner with industry to help achieve the government's goal of advancing economic development and eradicating poverty. In fact, central and provincial governments have worked closely with major companies such as PepsiCo and Coca-Cola on eradicating poverty, especially in rural areas, a historic central government priority. All the while, political leaders, since the days of Deng Xiaoping, 1978 to 1992, to the current president, Xi Jinping, 2012 to present, have viewed these industries and the private sector in general as vital to helping develop China's economic and social prosperity. In the end, it appears that these complementary institutions have helped to increase industry's broader political acceptability and policy influence. Finally, South Africa, the African continent's largest economy, has also struggled with the two-way road of junk food politics. After several years of geopolitical and economic isolation due to apartheid rule, eventually major soda and ultra-processed food industries entered South Africa's market with gusto, flourishing and providing new opportunities backed by the new Democratic President Nelson Mandela in 1994. The burgeoning growth and consumption of these junk food products has nevertheless contributed to an ongoing increase in obesity and type 2 diabetes, afflicting not only children, who now lead the African region in overall obesity cases, but also the urban and rural poor. In a context of ongoing malnourishment, poverty, and HIV/AIDS, the Department of Health was slow to respond. When it did, it emphasized the introduction of public health prevention campaigns, such as improved nutrition, balanced diets, and exercise. While a soda tax was eventually introduced, it took several years to be passed by Parliament, while the tax was substantially reduced. Even further disheartening has been the inadequacy of food labels and the absence of any regulation for advertising and selling these products to children. Instead, the government has encouraged industry self-regulation through company pledges not to market products to children, especially near schools, but this too has been repeatedly ignored by these companies. But why did these outcomes emerge? Once again, industry politics mattered, and this entailed a host of political tactics. For instance, several industries engaged in health policy partnerships with government officials, such as working with government to provide physical education programs in schools. At the same time, these industries and their interest group representatives, such as the Beverage Association of South Africa, aggressively lobbied the government to successfully delay and water down the 2018 soda tax. But several companies, such as Nestle and Coca-Cola, also engaged in a host of CSR initiatives, ranging from the provision of health care to job training, in turn helping build social support and legitimacy. As we saw in several other countries, however, these activities have contributed to the emergence of a divided society, where industry's relationship with NGOs and academics has generated conflict and a lack of collaboration with other activists seeking to raise attention about NCDs and to hold these industries accountable. While the activist community in the area of nutrition is new, it is troubled by a lack of adequate resources and attention. Nevertheless, activist efforts continue and are gradually building greater attention and awareness to the need to improve the health of children and the poor. But industry alone cannot be blamed for South Africa's ongoing efforts to introduce more effective NCD regulations and improve the health of its most vulnerable populations. Once again, the government is also to blame. Indeed, since the Nelson Mandela administration, 1994 to 1999, to current-day President Cyril Ramaphosa of the ANC political party, 2018 to present, presidents have strengthened their partnerships with junk food industries in order to achieve these politicians' priorities to improve the economy, provide jobs, tackle poverty, and ensure food security. In essence, these complementary institutions have once again served to indirectly support the junk food industry and its unrelenting efforts to influence policy and politics. Thus, in sum, the countries of Mexico, Brazil, India, China, Indonesia, and South Africa have revealed that the political power and influence of junk food industries is strong, enduring, and obstructing the creation of NCD regulatory policies. Unfortunately, and as we will see, it seems that most governments in these emerging economies still have not paid heed to former WHO Director Margaret Chan's initial warnings and recommendations to take on the power and interests of big business. Regardless of how innovative these governments have been at introducing NCD policies, even those focused on childhood obesity and type 2 diabetes for the most part, they are still far from willing to undercut the power and influence of industries through more aggressive regulatory policies. Junk food politics has interfered, and most importantly of all, it has interfered in ways that continue to impair the health and well-being of children and the poor in these thriving, developing nations. Methodological approach. I adopted a qualitative methodological approach to comparative historical research in preparation for writing this book. The empirical evidence used for the country case study chapters were obtained from several qualitative sources, such as books, peer-reviewed journal articles, policy reports, and credible newspaper sources. In-depth interviews with several activists, academic researchers, and NGO experts were also conducted for many of the country case study chapters. This interview data was used to provide further empirical evidence of the causal and factual claims made throughout this book. Interviews were conducted via Skype and Zoom communications in 2019, 2020, and 2021. With respect to case study selection, I selected and compared the countries of Mexico, Brazil, India, Indonesia, China, and South Africa for several reasons. First, these nations are arguably the largest emerging economies in their respective regions, with high levels of obesity and type 2 diabetes, particularly among children and the poor. Second, I sought to obtain global regional representation, that is, selecting countries from Latin America, Asia, and Africa. Third, these case studies were selected due to the rich availability of published literature on these countries and on the issues of concern in this book. Finally, these cases were selected in order to illustrate the potential utility of the IPCI, rather than striving to use these case studies to test and establish a generalizable theory through a deductive approach to causal inference. Instead, as I explain in Chapter 2, this analytical framework was inductive in its approach, that is, the IPCI's concepts were developed based on existing concepts and theories in political science and public health policy, as well as new theoretical concepts that I established, with the goal of better organizing and explaining complex causal events within countries, rather than predicting them and establishing generalizable theoretical claims, which is a key distinction between analytical and theoretical frameworks. But what was the purpose of my comparative analysis? The countries of Mexico, Brazil, India, Indonesia, China, and South Africa are different in many ways, seemingly incomparable. So why compare them? The goal was to illustrate and explain their unique politics, institutions, policies, and social movements, and their distinctive experiences in dealing with junk food industries, rather than treating them as similar generalizable cases, reflecting similar patterns of causality and outcomes over time. I therefore adopted Skocpol and Somers' notion of contrasts of contexts in comparative historical analysis for the purpose of highlighting unique causal mechanisms and outcomes between complex sets of cases. A roadmap. This book is broken up into several chapters. In the next chapter, I conduct a literature review and introduce readers to the IPCI. Chapter 2, titled Fear and Opportunity, then provides an explanation for why junk food industries are seeking to eagerly invest in emerging markets, setting the broader historical context for these industries' political and policy strategies in these countries. Chapter 3 closely examines the case of Mexico, followed by Brazil in Chapter 4, India in Chapter 5, Indonesia in Chapter 6, China in Chapter 7, and South Africa in Chapter 8. The conclusion summarizes the key findings from these chapters, as well as the theoretical and empirical lessons learned, while providing recommendations for policymakers. 1. interest group theory, institutions, and public health policy. The study of interest groups and public policy has a long tradition in the field of political science. This is particularly the case when it comes to studying healthcare policy in the United States. Indeed, one of the very first books to focus on interest group theory in American healthcare politics and the field of political science in general was Oliver Garceau's seminal discussion of the rise and policy influence of the American Medical Association. Over time, a phalanx of scholarly articles and books began to emerge, exploring the various contexts under which interest groups successfully manipulate public health policy in the United States and Western Europe. By the 1990s, the field of comparative politics also began to see discussions of interest groups and their interaction with political institutions and healthcare in other Western European democracies. Interest group theory has traditionally focused on the United States and Western European democracies. Little is known about how this theoretical approach informs the transformation of public health policy in developing nations. With this new scholarly topic only emerging in the past two decades, political scientists examining public health policy in developing nations have instead focused on other types of political and institutional issues as factors influencing health policy reform. Focuses include the impact of democratic consolidation on children's health, the importance of state capacity, government commitment, and leadership to eradicate HIV/AIDS and other diseases, the formal design and impact of political institutional arrangements, such as federalism, decentralization, and intergovernmental relations, and even ethnic divisions and HIV/AIDS policy contestation. Nevertheless, in the area of public health policy, it seems that political scientists have paid little attention to the role of professional interest groups in developing nations, their interaction with political institutions and civil society, and their ability to manipulate policy in their favor. This book strives to fill this lacuna in the literature. To do so, we first need to understand the major schools of thought with respect to interest group theory and their political activities in the health policymaking process, as well as the recent public health policy literature addressing these issues. In what follows, I lay out the main arguments in the existing literature, along with their strengths and weaknesses, with the ultimate objective of proposing an alternative analytical framework based on the literature's theoretical and contextual limitations. Titled Industry Politics and Complementary Institutions, the proposed analytical framework applies and builds on the existing literature in political science and public health policy to provide a more comprehensive picture and explanation of the complex interest group and institutional contexts facilitating junk food industries, ongoing ability to influence noncommunicable disease policy, and the emerging economies. Interest group theory and policy reform. In the field of political science, the study of interest group lobbying and political strategies for manipulating public policy has a long-standing tradition. Inspired mainly by the works of American politics scholars, several theoretical and methodological approaches have emerged to explain how private sector interest groups manipulate congressional voting and policy agenda-setting processes. Historically, much of this literature is focused on two areas, that is, what Gaius and Walker once referred to as insider versus outsider interest group political tactics. Because of this, I focus on the literature addressing these particular legislative and bureaucratic tactics that interest groups take, as well as their counterarguments. Insider lobbying strategies have traditionally focused on the various tactics that interest groups use within government to manipulate policy agenda-setting processes. More specifically, this literature focuses on the efforts made by industry lobbyists to directly meet with presidents, congressional politicians, and/or senior bureaucrats to persuade them into taking a particular stance on a proposed piece of legislation. This art of persuasion, if you will, occurs when lobbyists meet with these government officials to provide information such as scientific evidence supporting industry's policy interests, with the goal of changing these politicians' views through the dissemination of information and evidence. When the policy issue receives little media attention, thus dropping in its overall public and political saliency, and is more technical in nature, Culpepper claims that these lobbying activities often take place behind closed doors, dubbed quiet politics. McGrath also discusses how these industries often employ strategies commonly used by marketing firms to alter their language and organizational titles to make them more appealing and persuasive to politicians. Finally, an ongoing, well-known strategy is the simple act of direct bribery and corruption. In this context, lobbyists' tactics have included using campaign contributions to ensure that their policy interests are maintained and that legislators vote in their favor, revealing a context where legislators and lobbyists act as agents engaged in a mutual beneficial exchange. Though not explicitly applying political science interest group theory to their research, recent health policy scholars have unearthed similar kinds of industrial insider tactics. For several years, scholars have addressed the corporate political activity literature. In general, this literature focuses on the ways in which a variety of industries strive to influence policy through a myriad of political and social tactics. In recent years, Hillman and Hitt built on the existing CPA literature to put forth a more comprehensive approach explaining the various political tactics used by industry to influence policy. These tactics referred to what the authors described as information/messaging, that is, industries engaging in various lobbying activities, as described earlier, as well as sponsoring supportive scientific research. Next, industries engage in what Hillman and Hitt refer to as constituency building, that is, industries partnering with voters or local communities, who in turn pressure policymakers in support of an industry's policy views, thus emitting bottom-up pressures. Hillman and Hitt also describe financial incentives, which may take the form of industry-direct contributions to politicians and political parties. For example, providing speaking honorariums and paid travel expenses to influence votes and achieve industry's policy preferences. Saville and colleagues later developed a taxonomy of 6 strategies used by the tobacco industry to influence congressional votes on public health policy, while also introducing us to the various narratives used by these industries to shape policy discussions and agenda setting. This was achieved by emphasizing the unintended economic consequence of policy reform, legal and regulatory redundancy, and the existence of insufficient credible evidence. Saville and colleagues' 6 CPA strategies are as follows. 1. Information. That is, building upon Hillman and Hitt's discussion about lobbying while adding to this industry's effort to fund supportive scientific research, thus reformulating evidence and establishing policy partnerships with government, such as participating in government policy working groups and technical and advisory groups, as well as working with and providing advice to policymakers. Lima and Galea subsequently also referred to these kinds of information lobbying tactics, such as industry's usage of scientific information and expertise, though at times being biased, / having incomplete information, when discussing the food industry's tactics, influence, and power. 2. Financial incentives are used by lobbyists to engage in the aforementioned insider tactics of policy influence via direct and indirect financial incentives to legislators, even the offering of employment. 3. Constituency building, that is, building upon Hillman and Hitt's discussion of industry partnering with other sectors and communities in support of industry's policies, thus connoting broad support for industry's policy positions. See also discussions by Miller and Harkins and Moody and colleagues of the food industry on these related issues, while extending this to include partnerships with other industries supporting their policy position. 4. Legal. That is, using the law either as a preemptive strategy or a threat of legal action. 5. Policy substitution. That is, advocating for industry self-regulation in the area of marketing and sales. 6. Constituency fragmentation / destabilization. Encompasses strategies to discredit and prevent the emergence and influence of potential opponents in society. Political scientists have also underscored the outsider tactics used by industry lobbyists to sway agenda-setting processes. One strategy has been lobbyists' efforts to engage in what Keller refers to as noisy politics, or publicly sharing information about the proposed legislation through the usage of the media and other public venues, with the goal of increasing the overall political saliency of the issue. In this process, the author emphasizes the importance for industry lobbyists to carefully frame policy issues in ways that the general public can easily understand. By raising public awareness and the saliency of a policy issue, lobbyists exert external pressure and may incentivize politicians to refrain from pursuing costly legislation. Alternatively, Barry highlights how industries can use the media to publicly discredit existing policies, embarrass legislators, and in the process, motivate the latter to support industry's views. West and colleagues have also underscored that interest groups often use media ads not only to critique proposed healthcare policy proposals, but also to generate negative perceptions about the proposed legislation in society. This reveals the latter's distaste for policy proposals, ultimately motivating legislators not to pursue the legislation. Recent work in the CPA research illustrates the utility of participating in what political scientists refer to as outsider tactics. As the work of Miller and Harkin demonstrates, alcohol and food industries, for example, have expanded their lobbying efforts to include strategic communication strategies through their management of social media, civil society, NGOs, and academics, the science. For example, these industries often work with online magazines to convey their message about particular policies, publicly discrediting critics and skewing scientific evidence while financing NGOs or consulting firms, often working within government, even going so far as to create NGOs, in essence capturing society in order to convey industry's views and have influence over decision makers. Finally, in addition to these insider and outsider tactics, it is important to emphasize that interest groups have also strategically used their work with local communities to further augment their reputation, legitimacy, and by extension, policy influence. While political scientists have focused on the electoral legislative arena, sociologists and policy scholars have mainly addressed this issue through the literature on corporate social responsibility, often surfacing in response to civil societal protests and demands on industries to act ethically and responsibly. CSR activities emerge when industries voluntarily engage in a host of social and community activities. This is done to enhance their reputation as industries conscious of societal needs, displaying that they are ethically and morally responsible, with the objective of increasing their social and, by extension, political reputation and influence. In the area of food and NCD policy, Moody and colleagues have emphasized how industries often provide campaigns focused on preventing violence against women in order to reduce criticism of industry. Similarly, in the United Kingdom, Hastings has underscored the alcohol industry's efforts to empower women through midwife training programs, while working with NGOs to improve school education and other social services that will improve the alcohol industry's reputation as entities that are part of the solution to the alcohol problem. Alternatively, work by Fuchs and Gilmore has highlighted the ways that major tobacco industries, such as the British American Tobacco Corporation, have used philanthropy to increase access to politicians and bolster industry's reputation in providing important and trustworthy policy information. In particular, they reference how philanthropic efforts can increase the company's reputation and trust among legislators, in turn facilitating their ability to influence policy. Yet another CSR tactic employed by industry has been voluntary self-regulation. As the work of Vogel discusses, typically, in response to social protests and demands, industries will voluntarily pledge to engage in activities that display their dedication to acting in an ethical and responsible manner. Moreover, Vogel maintains that industries often pursue these self-regulations as a strategy, with the goal of incentivizing the government not to pursue additional policy regulations. As Vogel further points out, these self-regulations are soft laws, different from hard laws, in that they do not entail any enforcement mechanisms, an ongoing problem, as we will soon see in the emerging economies. In the area of NCD policy, this tactic has been increasingly popular among major food industries. They do so mainly by engaging in public pledges or agreements with government to restrict the sale and marketing of their products toward children, or by improving the nutritional content of their foods. The goal has not only been to increase the industry's political and social reputation, but rather, and following Vogel, to convince government officials that no further costly regulations on industry are required. While I certainly break bread with these scholars in emphasizing the importance of these interest group tactics, such as the political science and CPA literature's emphasis on insider tactics, several limitations still remain. First, in the area of junk food politics, more than ever, industries are reluctant to engage in outsider policy tactics. Junk food industries and their supportive interest groups often fear the negative political, social, and possible financial ramifications of publicly obstructing the creation of NCD policies, such as obesity prevention, especially those geared toward children. Instead, they prefer to be seen as solutions to the problem by openly working with government and civil society and engaging in supportive CSR activities to overcome the harmful health effects of their products. Second, this literature does not address the broader social consequences of interest group tactics, especially with respect to civil society's ability to effectively mobilize in response to industry's obstruction of regulatory policy. Third, this literature pays essentially no attention to how interest groups strategically use institutions, such as federal bureaucratic agencies, to ensure that their policy ideas are firmly in place to safeguard their interests. And finally, this literature does not address how industry CSR activities supplement national insider political tactics to further increase industry's political legitimacy and policy influence. In accordance with Bernhagen and Patsiorko and Walker and Rea, this research needs to explore how, when, and to what extent CSR supplements insider and outsider industry tactics. However, some studies suggest that relying exclusively on interest group tactics is not enough. Sometimes interest groups engage in a variety of insider or outsider tactics, but do not achieve their policy objectives. On the other hand, industry's desired objectives may emerge in the absence of these interest group tactics, often due to policymakers' personal views, support, and unforeseen events, or what De Bruckier and Byers refer to as exogenous factors or even lucky coincidence. De Bruckier and Byers go on to explain that there is therefore no guarantee that lobbying tactics are sufficient for explaining policy influence. Alternatively, other interest group scholars have emphasized the importance of contextual conditions rather than industry tactics, such as organizational or political contexts that facilitate the emergence of effective insider and outsider tactics. Indeed, other political scientists emphasize the organizational power and resources of interest groups, which in turn determine whether they can and are willing to engage in insider or outsider tactics in the first place. In this camp, Gaius and Walker were among the first to claim that the lobbying industry's policy success rests on the cohesiveness and adaptability of its organizational structure. This includes the ability to overcome internal conflicts of interest, as well as having the financial resources needed to engage in the preferred lobbying activities. Moreover, the authors also highlighted the importance of possessing technical knowledge on particular sectors to improve their credibility and persuasiveness. As Hojnacki and colleagues explain, the amount of resources interest groups have shapes their legislative tactics. The civics groups with access to fewer financial resources, when compared to business-based interest groups, had to be more careful and selective in where and how they were spending their money during advocacy campaigns, while considering the visibility of their efforts. In this context, moreover, findings by Figueiredo and Richter confirm that smaller lobbying firms are less likely than larger firms to engage in lobbying activities because they have fewer resources. Barry, and later DeBrookier, added the importance of these industries' ability to have strong internal communication structures and thus make decisions more quickly. However, what also mattered for Gaius and Walker was where these financial and technical resources came from. That is, if these resources were acquired from NGOs or activists, industries were more likely to engage in the aforementioned outsider tactics of working with these groups to raise public awareness and confront lawmakers. Alternatively, when these resources were acquired from big businesses, lobbyists were more likely to engage in insider tactics. Binderkranz and colleagues have nevertheless claimed that the reason some lobbyists are more successful than others has to do with their cumulative access to several political arenas. That is, the same interest groups have the same access to several arenas over time, which in turn is shaped by a group's vast resources. This leads to a sense of privileged pluralism. However, research by Grossman finds that interest group organizational resource capacity was not a key factor in explaining their ability to influence policy. Through an innovative historical policy analysis of 268 policy decisions in the United States from 1945 to 2004 across 14 policy sectors, Grossman found that advocacy-based organizations with comparatively fewer resources, for example, when compared to businesses and unions, were the most influential with respect to policy change. These advocacy associations were more influential because of their strong reputation for representing particular constituencies. Similar to Grossman, Lorenz also discovered that the large size of interest groups, their homogeneous status, and massive campaign contributions does not necessarily guarantee their ability to influence policy agenda-setting processes. Instead, what is more important is the diversity of interests present within lobbying coalitions, the information that they provide to congressional committees, and the latter's willingness to see these diverse interests as viable policies and interests to pursue them, which in turn is shaped by a committee's perception of bills supported by a party majority or divided government. Finally, rather than focus on interest group tactics and their organizational capacity, political scientists have focused on the nature of political institutions and their ability to determine if and to what extent these groups can access politicians and bureaucrats, which legislative tactics they can take, and if they will be successful. Here the work of Ishio, for example, claims that industry's ability to participate in insider or outsider tactics is shaped first and foremost by the design of political and bureaucratic institutions. For example, the United States' complex checks and balances system, especially with respect to limited bureaucratic autonomy, which provides lobbyists with several potential avenues of influence, as well as its direct election of political candidates, can encourage a combination of insider and outsider tactics. By contrast, Japan's more consensual decision-making structure, greater autonomy in bureaucratic decision-making, along with a political party system that is more cohesive in nature, has encouraged the usage of insider tactics. Alternatively, Hutchison emphasizes how the U.S. Congress's decision in the 1970s to increase the decentralization of policy deliberations by introducing several subcommittees in the U.S. House of Representatives has gradually forced interest groups to alter their insider lobbying tactics. As seen in the House on issues such as labor policy, this is especially the case when new committees introduce legislative representatives with alternative ideological and policy views on labor policy, thus requiring more convincing information from interest groups, such as the provision of technical information. Conversely, when interest groups encounter legislative committees with more support, as seen with policy issues focused on the environment, representative interest groups need only provide less costly political information. While this book certainly agrees with the importance of institutional designs, which includes access to politicians, bureaucratic committees, and the federal courts, and how this in turn influences interest group insider tactics, this literature is limited in several areas. First, following Gómez, it does not underscore how interest groups' access to institutions over a long period of time amplifies their policy influence. Moreover, it does not address how interest groups strategically infiltrate institutions, such as the bureaucracy, with their policy ideas and interests, ultimately ensuring that their policy interests are sustained. Additionally, this literature does not address what I describe as the importance of complementary institutions, that is, important agenda-setting institutions, such as the Office of the Presidency, that can also serve to complement and reinforce interest group political tactics, legitimacy, and influence within government. While political scientists have acknowledged the importance of political context, such as legislative activity and being positively associated with interest group density and response, though they also find a positive relationship between interest group density and legislative activity over time, support of presidential contexts can also serve to indirectly complement, rather than compete with, interest group interests, tactics, and strategies, as I discuss in more detail shortly. The New Politics of Junk Food Industries and Policy Manipulation. In explaining the rise and political influence of junk food industries in the emerging economies, this book comports with several aspects of the aforementioned political science, insider, interest group research, public health CPA, and social responsibility literature, while nevertheless addressing their theoretical and contextual shortcomings. More specifically, the analytical approach taken in this book applies and builds on the importance of interest group insider, CPA, and social responsibility tactics, as well as the importance of institutional design and industry manipulation of bureaucratic institutions, while also revealing an alternative complementary role that presidential institutions play in supplementing these industry activities. My focus on the emerging economies introduces yet another limitation with the existing political science, CPA, and social responsibility literature. The first centers on the fact that this literature to date has focused mainly on consolidated democracies within the United States and Western Europe, with the exception of recent studies addressing this topic in developing nations. To my knowledge, essentially no research has been conducted on an in-depth comparative historical analysis of the junk food industry's political and policy tactics across several emerging economies, as well as their relationship with the bureaucracy, political leaders, and civil society. However, because of this, we do not know to what extent these efforts are present and help to explain NCD policy obstructions in the developing world. Furthermore, without an in-depth comparative historical analysis, we cannot discover and explain the alternative political and social tactics that these interest groups engage in, their broader policy and social consequences, and the vital role of political context, particularly at the domestic and international level, due to the developing world's increased global integration and the ongoing influence of international policy ideas and power. But this book argues that, in this alternative domestic and international context, major junk food industries and their representatives have pursued several types of political and social tactics, becoming increasingly entrepreneurial and successful in their efforts to obstruct any and all NCD policies challenging their ability to conduct business. But why is this the case? Why have industries in these countries been more creative and aggressive in pursuing alternative approaches to NCD policy obstruction? We must first understand the broader historical context generating these types of activities in the first place. In essence, it's all about fear and opportunity. Due to an increasingly health-conscious market in the West, industries fear a continued decrease in sales and profitability. As Chapter 2 explains, in recent years, junk food industries have seen a precipitous decline in sales within their traditional Western markets, such as the United States and Europe. Though delayed when compared to these nations, the international wave of public awareness and interest in good nutrition and health is finding its way to emerging markets. This trend concerns these industries and makes them all the more eager to find creative political and social strategies to safeguard their NCD policy interests. At the same time, opportunity matters. These industries are taking advantage of a gradual rise in income among the middle class and poor in emerging markets, which is often the result of popular anti-poverty programs providing disposable cash to these members of the population. Furthermore, these industries are taking advantage of the excessive concentration of political power at the highest levels of government, which often facilitates their ability to have an impact on the policy-making discussions of the political elite. As Gómez and Menéndez have argued, in the realm of public health policy in Latin America, a very small concentration of political and bureaucratic elites often make the most critical policy decisions on their own without adequately consulting civil society. These industries know this and have taken strategic advantage of this context. Indeed, unlike democracies in the advanced industrialized world, where due to a longer history of democracy, vibrant political parties reflect strong social movements, it seems that big businesses in nascent democracies often face fewer countervailing political forces and credible threats to policy interests. Junk food industries in the emerging economies therefore appear to have considerably more power and influence than in mainly Western-based pluralist democracies, where they may at times be forced to choose between policy adaptation and defeat due to staunch political party opposition. Establishing a new analytical framework, industry politics, and complementary institutions. In order to provide a more comprehensive explanation of junk food industries' political and policy influence in the emerging economies, this book introduces an analytical framework titled Industry Politics and Complementary Institutions. The IPCI builds on the theoretical and empirical limitations of the aforementioned political science and public health policy literature. The goal of the IPCI is to better explain the NCD policy agenda setting and implementation processes in these economies. That is why and how NCD prevention and regulatory policies become a national priority, and why existing legislation may not be enforced. The IPCI is used to explain the reasons why, for example, presidents and legislative institutions do not pursue specific NCD policies, such as soda taxes or marketing/sales regulations, or why they do not enforce these policies by means of monitoring and imposing penalties for non-compliance. The IPCI combines an analysis of historical contextual backdrop and the causal mechanisms linking industry political activity and the role of institutions in policy outcomes. As previously mentioned, it begins with the broader historical context of fear and opportunity as explanations for why industries pursue the emerging economies and become political entities in the first place. Next, the IPCI focuses on the specific processes that industries as well as governments engage in. In the area of industry called political action, The IPCI applies the political science and health policy literature on insider lobbying and CPA. The institutional infiltration and conversion literature, and, in the area of restructuring society, industry strategies for shaping civil societal views and interests, as well as their ramifications for civic mobilization. At the same time, however, the IPCI maintains that domestic institutions also matter. That is, these industry tactics are greatly facilitated by the complementary role of presidents, who are supportive of industry, and seeking to work closely with industries to achieve alternative economic and social welfare policies and political objectives. This process reflects the presence of complementary institutions as intervening variables, both complementing and reinforcing the tactics of political action and restructuring society, in turn, contributing to industry's legitimacy and policy influence, and ultimately, the ineffectiveness and absence of NCD regulatory policies. Political action. In the emerging economies today, interest groups representing junk food industries, as well as industries themselves, have employed a host of creative insider and CPA strategies to achieve their primary objective. They work to not only limit the creation of public health prevention programs, discouraging the consumption of their products, such as a soda tax, but perhaps more importantly, to prevent any and all legislation proposing to regulate the marketing and sale of their products. The first political tactic that industries use is nothing new. They often seek to partner with politicians and government officials, often through government workshops/committees, to create innovative public health programs tackling NCDs. Industries may also work closely with government officials to improve the overall quality of ingredients in foods and food labeling. Moreover, these industries may also enter into formal agreements with governments to restrict the advertising of their products to children, also known as self-regulation. Through these crafty political tactics, as well as through CSR activities, industries want to ensure that they are viewed within government as the solution to the problem of industrial epidemics. Importantly, the IPCI also builds on Vogel's position that these tactics are mainly used to avoid the creation of any further regulations harming industry's interests. By partnering with government on NCD prevention programs and food reformulation initiatives, this generates trust and support from government officials toward industry, viewing them as genuine allies in the plight against obesity and type 2 diabetes among children, adolescents, and the poor, believing that industry is doing its part in helping the government stem the rising tide of NCDs. Consequently, politicians often have no interest and incentive to pursue alternative regulations that may jeopardize their relationship with industry. And yet, industry's goal is not altogether altruistic in striving to safeguard these vulnerable populations from NCDs. Instead, industry's political activities are often used to establish enduring government allies, such as with politicians, who can be trusted to never cross the line in support of legislation restricting the marketing and sale of industry products. As we will see in several countries discussed in this book, companies such as Coca-Cola, PepsiCo, Nestle and Unilever have been very proactive in seeking out government officials and local schools to work with and create programs focused on increased physical fitness and exercise, while at the same time working with governments to adopt limited policy regulations, such as improving nutritional content and information about their foods, for example, food labeling. To achieve these endeavors, industries and the interest groups or NGOs they work with are often proactive in organizing one-on-one meetings with health officials, while involving themselves with national and local government committees, often co-organized with industry leaders. In addition, the IPCI applies the rich literature on interest group lobbying and largesse to influence public health policy. Building on this literature, the IPCI reinforces the fact that these political strategies are also occurring and the emerging economies in response to proposed NCD prevention and regulatory policies. Indeed, industries in several countries discussed in this book have engaged in numerous lobbying tactics to obstruct the creation of these policies. As the IPCI emphasizes, yet another tactic that junk food industries engage in is the process of institutional infiltration. And this process occurs when industries or their representatives, for example, NGOs, strive to occupy bureaucratic institutions in order to ensure that their interests are represented, incessantly pressuring policymakers, in a sense assuming an internal bureaucratic lobbying process, while establishing their policy ideas and interests within existing federal bureaucratic agencies to ensure that their views are safeguarded and maintained over time. Here, the IPCI builds on the work of several scholars recognizing how external actors, for example, civil society, can purposefully infiltrate institutions in order to achieve their objectives. For example, through their analytical framework, Politics of Infiltration, Klein and Lee, highlight the proactive efforts of civil societal actors to infiltrate institutions, what they refer to as the politics of forward infiltration and occupation. In an instance of institutional occupation, after ongoing bargaining with state actors, social movements gradually obtain a presence within state institutions to ensure that society's interests and agendas are established, thus reforming pre-existing institutions to society's liking. Ultimately, these reformulated institutions leave little choice for incumbent state actors but to adopt the institutional infiltrators, civil society's, reformulated institutions. Similarly, Valetti claims that after state intrusion into society, social movements may then infiltrate institutions with their interests and health policy ideas in order to build sustainable coalitions of support for these movements' ideas within bureaucratic institutions. Discussing the case of Brazil, Valetti asserts that social health movements such as the pro-democratic Sanitarista social movement, dedicated to establishing universal health care as a human right during the transition to democracy, gradually established their own presence within federal agencies, as well as municipal governments and international health agencies, introducing and sustaining their particular policies, maintaining a strong network of societal and state government support, and redirecting health policy reforms established by the military to achieve new healthcare objectives. These objectives included achieving universal healthcare as a right and provided by the state in a decentralized, participatory manner through the new democratic constitution of 1988. As the IPCI explains, junk food industries may take a similar approach by infiltrating federal healthcare agencies through allied NGOs in society, as the seminal contribution of Greenhalgh explains in the case of China. NGOs such as the International Life Sciences Institute often clandestinely infiltrate public health agencies, implant their ideas and policy prescriptions, and in the process, transform NCD policies in industry's favor. Restructuring society. At the same time, the IPCI emphasizes that industries are equally as committed to restructuring civil society in their favor. To this end, several strategies are pursued. First, applying and building on the aforementioned CPA strategy of constituency building, industries work hard to create supportive allies within academia. Industries often seek out influential academics from prestigious universities that will conduct research and provide evidence supporting industry's policy views on nutrition, NCDs, and the effectiveness of existing policies, such as soda taxes. However, the process industries use to approach academics is often clandestine and indirect, such as funneling money through seemingly independent private foundations and philanthropies who in turn provide funding to academic researchers. Ultimately, the objective is to not only obtain scientific evidence supporting industry claims but also to alter the discourse surrounding the root causes of NCDs. The second strategy that industries pursue is to establish strong, mutually reinforcing alliances with ideologically sympathetic NGOs and poor communities. With respect to NGOs, industries often seek to support advocates who provide research and public campaign messages highlighting the importance of individual liberty in food consumption, as well as the importance of physical exercise and overall happiness as an essential ingredient for prosperous living. These NGOs also work with local communities, such as schools and families, on behalf of these industries. In so doing, these NGOs act as hired middlemen, shaping community views through a variety of tactics. These efforts resemble and build on Walker and Rhea's Discussion of Corporations Mobilizing Society by hiring NGOs or think tanks in support of industry's views, as well as hiring consulting firms to engage grassroots lobbying campaigns that help to marshal supportive public opinion about particular policy issues. With respect to poor communities, junk food industries may reduce public criticism and build a strong support base by providing critical social services, activities that build on the aforementioned CSR literature. An increasingly common strategy has been the provision of community jobs in return for helping sell and market food products. Poor families receive a monthly income and a sense of empowerment and independence. At the same time, industries build a strong social support base by financing and organizing popular community events, for example, by sponsoring local sports clubs, as well as providing t-shirts and equipment in communities that cannot afford them. Industries generate social support, acceptability, and legitimacy for their products. Thus, to further ensure that their various political and institutional tactics work and help to guarantee their legislative policy influence, junk food industries supplement these efforts with additional tactics geared toward civil society. De Breyker and Byers claim that legislative tactics on their own are often insufficient for ensuring that interest groups achieve their desired policy objectives. De Breyker and Byers further maintain that interest groups' creation of heterogeneous coalitions, which rely on a diverse and representative constituency, can exert a more credible and encompassing signal of societal support when compared to coalitions consisting of a narrower set of organized interests, for example, only environmental NGOs or only business interests. While the interest group social tactics described in this book do not fall in line with traditional outsider tactics, as mentioned earlier, the aforementioned IPCI tactics in society can help to further augment junk food industry's legitimacy and influence within government, in turn supplementing and further reinforcing their insider tactics. This view aligns with others claiming that business civil mobilization tactics can often complement and industry's lobbying activities within government. Nevertheless, while industry strategies to restructure and mobilize civil societal support may often be successful, the scholarly literature to date has overlooked the broader social consequences of these efforts. As Gómez maintains, a key area that the literature has failed to address is how these strategies contribute to increased division and conflict between those nutrition activists who defend the public's health and those academic researchers or NGOs working with industry, in turn hampering civil society's ability to create a unified voice and to engender an effective social movement in response to industry's activities. The IPCI applies and illustrates the efficacy of Gómez's claim that by industry supporting those academic researchers or NGOs.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.